So when we look at the world, we have this sense that things aren't necessarily right. Because when we look at the news, we see stories of human trafficking. We see stories of people being abused, whether that's physically, mentally, emotionally, or sexually. We see all these things that happen that internally we just know are not right. When we look at how people treat each other on different sides of like the political spectrum, if you're a Republican, then you're supposed to hate Democrats. If you're a Democrat, then you're supposed to hate Republicans. If we look at our world, then we know that things just aren't right. And when we look at the kingdom of God, we realize that the kingdom of God is shaped differently than the world. When we look at the world, it is all about taking and what we can get and how do we put ourselves ahead. But when we look at the kingdom of God, it is not about us. It is about what God wants for the world. It is about what we can do for the person next to us. It is about what we can do to make God's name great. And so tonight, the story that we're going to look at, the part of scripture that we're going to look at addresses this idea of God's kingdom versus the kingdom of the world. And we're going to be in Luke 10. Luke is the third book of the New Testament. It is one of the Gospels. You guys know this by now. The Gospels are the good news, and it's the good news of Jesus Christ. And so we're looking in Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25. And it says this: "One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him questions." What we have to realize right here is that this time in Jesus's ministry is right in the middle. Jesus has gained popularity, and so the people who were in charge, the people who had influence, didn't like that. And so, yes. Sorry, like Chris waving was like, squirrel. And so the people who were in charge didn't like that Jesus was gaining influence. And so Jesus is teaching, and the thing about it was Jesus was teaching about the kingdom of God. And it went against the things of this world, because in the world, it was the people with power. It was the people with military might. It was the people with money that mattered. But Jesus was saying, it doesn't matter about that. It matters how willing are you to be used by God to help the world know that he loves them. Jesus said that the kingdom of God was different than the kingdom of this world. And so the people that were benefiting from the kingdom of this world were beginning to get uneasy with Jesus. And so Jesus is teaching, and the religious leader stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" The thing that we see right there is that this teacher, he's actually a lawyer. And so this lawyer is like, you know what? I want to find out the answer for how do I achieve happiness? How do I achieve enlightenment? How do I achieve whatever? But what we see is that it is, again, the world's measurement versus God's measurement. And this guy is saying, what do I have to do? How do I have to earn it? What measure do I have to go to in order to be happy, in order to be complete, in order to be who I was created to be? And so in 26, it says this: "Jesus replied, 'What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?'" So what we have here is Jesus again. Man, when you get to know Jesus, you realize that Jesus is amazing. And not just because he's the Son of God, but because of the person that Jesus was. Because when we look at Jesus, Jesus is someone who constantly has the right answer. It means that he had to know something about everything, right? And so Jesus right here meets this guy exactly where he is. If this guy's a lawyer, Jesus brings that in and says, "What does the law of Moses have to say? How do you read that?" Now, the law of Moses is where we get the Ten Commandments from. The Ten Commandments were the basis for the law of Moses. The Ten Commandments were the basis so that they had those 10 things that were given to them in the Old Testament, and then they built laws around that. The thing that we have to remember, even though we're going to talk, we're going to go in a different direction in just a second, the thing that we have to remember is that when the law of Moses was established, mankind, humanity, didn't know how to follow God. And that they had been serving gods who were nothing like the God of heaven. And so the law of Moses was set down so that they could understand the character of who God was, so that they would understand how he wanted to have relationship. Hey, Brent, can you talk to them right there? So that they can have relationship with God. And so what we see is that Jesus meets him where he is, and the law of Moses wasn't even there to set up as rules to say you're in heaven or out of heaven. They were set in place so that you could know the character of who God was. And so what Jesus says is, tell me, what does the law of Moses say, and how do you read it? And then in verse 27, the man answers, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And you must love your neighbor as yourself. Right there, he lays out the two greatest commandments in Scripture. Love God with everything that you are, and love your neighbor as yourself. Basically, love God and love man. Love your neighbor and love God. That takes us to the very heart of what the gospel is. The gospel is not, hey, you know what? Let's do a good deed and get a check mark. The gospel is not, hey, don't cheat on your test at school and get a check mark. The gospel is not, don't lie and get a check mark. The gospel is all about love. That is the heart of the scripture. It is the heart of the gospel. It is the heart of the creator of the universe. The idea of love being the center of it all ultimately separates Christianity from every other world religion. Because every other world religion talks about earning or achieving eternity or enlightenment. It talks about having to do something to be able to gain something. Whereas Christianity is all about relationships. God loved us and sent Jesus. So as a result, we love God and love who God loves. Christianity is about relationships, relationship with God and relationship with people. This idea also contradicts the world because it is about God taking a step towards us. It is about God saying, you know what? I'm God. I don't need humanity, but I love humanity. And so I'm going to do what it takes for them to have relationship with me. Christianity is about giving. And the world in our mindset is about taking. Think about that. For us to achieve in the world is us earning things or doing and making ourselves feel better. How do we feel? But the gospel is about how do we help someone else feel the love of Jesus Christ, the love of God. The world says take, but God says give. In 28, Jesus responds after this great answer. He says, right, do this and you will live. Jesus gives him props and then he explains the gospel. He's like, yes, if you love God with everything that you are, right? If you love God, and that doesn't mean like this conditional love where you love God and then you try to make sure that you don't do enough to screw up. It's this idea that says that your heart is genuinely given over to God to say, God, what would you have me do here? God, what would you have me do there? God, how would you have me act? How would you have me act in my dating relationships? How would you have me act in school? How would you have me act at my house? It's saying, God, I'm dedicated to you no matter what. Jesus lays it down and he says, that's exactly right. When we trust God with everything that we are, then we can truly be who we were created to be. Jesus says, do this and you will live. He's saying, love God with everything you are and love your neighbor as yourself and you will live. Because it comes down to relationship, but it's those relationships that will help you be who you were created to be. But then the lawyer shows that he wasn't really listening. In 29, it says, the man wanted to justify his actions. He was uncomfortable with this idea that he couldn't do something to earn eternal life. How many of us are like that, right? Like, we're like, you know what? I need to feel like I accomplished something. I need to feel like I earned my way. I need to feel like I'm good enough. But that's how this guy felt. And he said it says he wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? right? It wasn't good enough that that Jesus said, go love your neighbor, right? He wanted to really define that. You know what? I don't really want to love everybody, but I want to know exactly who I have to love, right? Let's narrow it down as far as we can. That's what this guy was saying. And he says, so who is my neighbor? Jesus again meets the man where he is. Jesus is like, I think in Jesus's head, he's like, he probably didn't do it out like so that the guy could see it, but inside he's like, ugh. He's like the shaking of the head because he's like, this guy just does not get it. But again, just like he does with us, Jesus wants to meet you where you are in every area of your life, in every life circumstance that you face. Jesus met this guy where he was, and so he begins to tell this story. And starting in verse 30, it says this. Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho. The thing is, the religious leader would have been Jewish. Jesus was Jewish. They lived in a Jewish culture, right? And so Jesus is speaking to a Jewish culture. So he's saying a Jewish man, because that's who would have been around them, was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. And he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes and beat him up and left him half dead beside the road. The thing was, this guy was just traveling. We don't know. Maybe he was traveling to go see relatives. Maybe he was traveling for business. But it wasn't anything unusual about traveling that road. The problem was, this was a very this road was traveled all the time for business. And like large of sums of money were transported back and forth. And like goods were transported back and forth. And so bandits would hang out. And the mountain, it wasn't just like a straight highway. It was like through, they weren't really mountains, but like through the hills and back and forth. And so there were places for bandits to hide all over the place. And so typically, you wouldn't travel that road alone, right? There are probably places in Tucson that you're like, I wouldn't walk there by myself, right? Like if you're my wife, she's like, I'm not going to walk anywhere after dark by myself. But the idea is that this is somewhere that wasn't unusual for him to go on this road, but he shouldn't have gone by himself. And so he's doing his daily thing. This guy's walking. And then all of a sudden, bandits jump out. And apparently he didn't have what they wanted because they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him up, and they left him half dead beside the road. They're like, you don't have anything we want, so we're just going to beat you up and leave you here to die. And so then, by chance, the other thing is, this would have been a scenario that the people that Jesus is talking to, he would have understood. They would have understood this, right? They probably knew somebody that had been robbed on this road. They knew that this was not a good situation to be in. And then Jesus continues, by chance, a priest came along. The thing about this is, when we say priest, it's hard for us to kind of understand that in today's culture. A priest in the Jewish culture would have been like a lead pastor, right? It would have been like Trevor, right? And so Trevor, I think, is probably cooler than whatever priest this was. But let's picture Trevor like walking along this road, right? And he's walking along and he's got business things on his mind and he's thinking about all the business of the church and of the temple and all of these things. The priest is somebody who is very holy. To the point where they would be on a rotation where they would be able to come into the very presence of God, right? They would be able to go into the Holy of Holies and be able to make sacrifices. This was a big deal. This meant that this person had to be very committed to the things of God. And so, you know what? This dude is laying half dead on the road. And so if anybody's going to stop, it's going to be the priest. It's going to be the lead pastor, right? And so what we see is, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road. That means the man's right there and he's walking along and he's like probably singing some praise hymn and he's like, doo, 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 ooh, and like walks to the other side of the road. The guy didn't just say that, like, it doesn't say like he was walking along and didn't see the guy, right? He saw him and then he walks completely to the other side of the road. Now, the thing about this is, if the priest had touched a dead body, if the guy had been dead, then he would have been unclean for several days and he wouldn't have been able to do the job that he had. He wouldn't have been able to be in the presence of other priests. He would have had to isolate himself. So he justifies that in his mind. It wasn't like he looked at the guy and was like, ugh, and walked away. He had a reason in his mind. But we have to remember, what's the heart of the gospel? The heart of the gospel is relationships. The heart of the gospel is helping everyone know that God loves them. And so the priest walks by on the other side. Second, in verse 32, it says a temple assistant walked over. Now, a temple assistant would be somebody who isn't a priest, isn't like a lead pastor. It would be kind of like me, right? I'm an associate pastor. I am a student pastor who is running or helps run a ministry in the church. I'm not over the entire church, right? And so it would be like me walking by, and it'd be the same thing as the priest. And so the associate pastor, the temple assistant walks up, and he walked over and looked at him lying there. But he also passed by on the other side. Come on. The lead pastor walks by. The youth pastor walks by. Those are the two people, though you would think that in a religious culture, those would be the people that would help. Then Jesus comes to the point of the story. Then a despised Samaritan came along. The thing about it is, it says despised Samaritan because Jews hated Samaritans. They hated Samaritans. Back in the Old Testament, the Jewish people were supposed to have relationship with God. And the thing was, they would follow God, and then they would not follow God, and then they would follow God, and then they would not follow God. And so God would use other countries to come in and oppress them. And he would say, hey, this will cause you to have to rely on me through this suffering, right? And so they would be taken over by another country, and then they would cry out to God and God would save them, right? And this happened over and over and over and over. Well, one of those times when they got conquered by another country, that country took everybody who had any talents or abilities out of the country, right? And the only people that were left were like the marginalized of the culture. They were the people who were the lowest income, all of the things that would not be desirable to a country trying to grow. Those were the people that were left, right? And so what happened was, Jews were not supposed to marry people who were not Jews. But the people who were left married the other people of that country. And so when the Jews came back to the promised land, they hated the Samaritans because the Samaritans had chosen to marry someone other than Jews, right? And the Samaritans hated Jews because they looked down on them and treated them like trash, right? The closest thing that we can have to understanding this is when we think about the South in the 50s during civil rights. The tension that was there between races, the hate that was felt on many sides of the equation, right? And so it says a despised Samaritan. Jesus is fishing right here and is luring this guy in. He's pulling him in because he's like, the Jewish guy would have been like, oh yeah, despised Samaritans. We hate them. That's right. Jesus pulls him in and he says the despised Samaritan. The audience would have thought Jesus is about to tell them that the Samaritan like came up and started kicking the guy or spitting on him. But Jesus doesn't do that. A despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. That means he felt love for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took him in. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. The Samaritan didn't just come meet the man where he was. The Samaritan got his hands dirty by helping to mend the wounds of a man that was left for dead. And then it's not enough that he sacrificed his time and like his comfort. He then uses his resources, his money, to help this man be bandaged up and to be taken care of. And so, what we see is Jesus is so amazing. Because Jesus takes the person that they thought would be the villain of the story and makes him the hero. He takes the person that everyone in the audience would have hated and says that's even someone that God can use. In verse 36, it says this. Now, which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus used the Samaritan because it drove home the point. The man asked, who was my neighbor? And he wanted Jesus to say, hey, anybody living on your street is your neighbor. He wanted Jesus to say, anyone who is a Jew is your neighbor. He wanted Jesus to say anything other than what Jesus said. Because what Jesus said was that your idea and your concept of narrowing it down is off. That your whole concept here is flawed. That it's not about minimizing. It's about maximizing. And so what it says in verse 37, the man replied, the one who showed him mercy. I love this and hate this because it drives the point home. The man doesn't even say the Samaritan. He wouldn't even speak the word Samaritan because he couldn't even fathom that the Samaritan would be the good person. He refused to accept that God's plan was for everyone. He refused to accept that even the person that he hated the most in the world could be used by God. Then Jesus puts a stamp on it in the second part of 37. He said, yes, now go and do the same. Jesus lays it out there, and with this small statement makes two very large points. He is saying that the kingdom of God is for everyone. He's not saying it's for the people in this room. He's not saying it's for the people that go to Pantano. He's not saying it's for the people that look pretty and are nice and dress cool. He's saying it's for everyone. And he's even driving home the point that by everyone, he means everyone. Because if you're like me, there are people that just frustrate you, right? They annoy you. Now, most of them are in other cars when I'm driving. But the fact is, there are people that just irritate you. Jesus is saying the kingdom of God is for those people. He's saying you can't draw lines because it's for everyone. No matter who they are, no matter what they've gone through, no matter what they've done. Let that sink into you, because no matter what you've done or what's been done to you or where you've been or who you are or what your last name is, there's a place for you in the kingdom of heaven. There's a place for you in God's mission. The second thing that Jesus drives home is that the Christian mission is to reach everyone. In World War II, 6 million Jews were massacred by the Nazis. They were put to death in firing squads and gas chambers. And it was because Hitler wanted to say, it's us and no one else. He wanted to say the Nazis were better than everyone else, and he wanted to blame anyone that was different. He wanted to blame gypsies. He wanted to blame minorities. He wanted to blame the Jews. And so 6 million died because Hitler wanted to feel like he was better than everyone else. Throughout World War II, there are stories of heroism and people doing amazing things. Normal people, everyday people doing amazing things. There's a man named Oscar Schindler. Oscar Schindler was just a businessman. But he came into the opportunity to open a business. And what he did was he began to hire Jews, because if the Jews had a job, then they wouldn't be sent to the firing squads. They wouldn't be sent to the gas chambers. And so one by one, he saved one Jew, and then he saved two, and then he saved a family. And at the end of the war, because Oscar Schindler was doing business with the Nazis, he became a war criminal. We're gonna watch a video clip that shows his reaction as he's about to leave.
It says whoever saves one life saves the world entire.
No idea. If I just...
There will be generations because of what you did.
I didn't do enough.
You did so much.
This car. Good, what about this car? Why did I keep the car? 10 people right there. 10 people. 10 more people. This pin. 2 people. This is gold. 2 more people. You would have given me 2 for at least 1. You would have given me 1. 1 more. 1 more person. Stand. For this, I could have become 1 poor person, and I didn't. I didn't.
Is overwhelmed by the fact that had he just sacrificed a little bit more, people would have been alive. He's overwhelmed by the fact that had he just not spent quite as much money, he could have saved lives. In Pima County, there are 95,000 students between 6th and 12th grade that don't know Jesus Christ. There are 95,000 students that are your age that don't know Jesus Christ. We have to realize that God put you where you are for a reason. He put you in the family you're in. He put you in the school you're in. He put you in every spot that you're in for a reason. It's not by chance. It's not by accident. He put you there so that every person that you encounter can know that Jesus loves them. What we have to realize is that every person that you encounter is your mission. We talked about the Good Samaritan, and we talked about how the Samaritan was despised by the Jews, but it was the Samaritan who was looked down on by the Jews and hated by the Jews, but it was him who said, I'm not going to allow those boundaries to stop me from helping this person know that they matter. What we have to think about tonight is what are you letting stop you from letting the world know that they matter? Because let's let that sink in. If you knew that you sitting at a different lunch table would help someone be able to know that they matter to God, Would you do it? If you knew that talking to someone who's not in your social group would help them begin to live the life that they were created for, would you do it? If you knew that getting out of your comfort zone would mean that one person wouldn't go to hell, would you do it? Because the question for us tonight is, what is stopping you? We're going to sing a couple of songs. And while we're singing, I want to challenge you, even if it means you being quiet and not singing. I want you to wrestle with the fact that God put you where you are to let everyone around you know that they matter. And I want you to wrestle with what is holding you back. What is keeping you from saying one word of encouragement? What is keeping you from reaching out to the kid that you know needs someone to care? And then what can you do about that this week?